I mean, the question is, what is that morphism? And this is really, that's the thing that they had in English, which I really love. It's a triple, where if you have two graphs, you have a push for, you have a morphism on vertices going in the direction you would think, maybe from vertices of the first graph to the vertices of the second graph, and you have a pullback from the flag that goes the opposite direction you would think, and then there's this very mysterious piece of additional data, which is sort of the flag viewing. The blue flag that disappeared. Okay? So let me do an example and tell you why this is good. So one thing you would technically want to do is, if you have two vertices, I'm going off of this one, so one morphism I would maybe love to do is, I would maybe do this too much, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, maybe I would put in an edge. So then it would be just the vertices go to the vertices, and the bad map side backwards would be these three sides go to this one goes to that one, this one goes to that one. Okay? And this mysterious component would be nothing. And then what I could do is, I maybe also want to contract the edge, so I can do this. So now I contracted the edge, so what if these two vertices now map to that vertex? These three flags map back to these three flags, these three flags map back to these three flags, but the two flags at the edge have disappeared because I contracted them. And so the additional piece of information says any flag that has disappeared has been contracted as an edge. Okay? And the thing is, of course, now, see, if I draw a morphism like this because I can compose morphisms, now you see why you need this additional piece of data, because you don't know the flags, you know, which flags disappeared now. If I go just go from this to this, if I don't tell you which two flags are paired and contracted, you will never find out. Okay, so that's the definition of this thing. And of course, so, what I'm dealing with is sort of, it's interesting, so I sort of get this ghost graph, I call it the ghost graph. So if I look at all the flags that disappeared, they all have to get paired. So this gives me a graph. So that's the ghost graph. So the ghost graph here, it sort of becomes, so the graph itself here from this, so for this morphism, this graph, the same graph here is the ghost graph. That's the, that's a cool from here to here, I say, like, group these two elements, contract them. So in that case, in this way, actually this is the important thing, so, the way fine categories I set up is, if you have examples dealing with graphs, the graphs are morphisms, not objects. The objects are actually just stars. They're just agglomerates of roll-up. Okay? And then the graphs come in as the ghost graph of these morphisms. So you see that this is a morphism just from the corolla, which means, so corolla is a one vertex, no edge graph. An aggregate is a distal unit of these, and this is from that second. Alright, and now I'm done, see? Yes? This was to get a final category. Oh, yeah, sorry, I didn't say that. So the point is that if I take the top category of this category graph, two operas, generalizing operas, and they're almost succeeding except that they are one category level below. They took the graph as objects and the morphisms. So what I did is more or less a categorification of this, and then it actually works out.
No,
this was motivated by generalizing operas, props, and so on. How does finally get into it? Through the function. So the way I think about it is sort of basically something like this. So you have an endpoint function which is blank, and that is supposed to be a Buddha for an endpoint function. So the way you think about this is as an endpoint function that doesn't have anything in it yet. So this is, but if I start fixing functors, then the thing that I might want to write down is fields phi 1 to phi n, and then this might be phi 1 to phi n. And then I sort of, but then I can write down through, so how do I get, and then I can look like an F matrix kind of thing. So if I have a target, if this thing is a target, so I have a morphism, say, a graph, so a complicated graph, to something like this. Okay? Then I would say, well, this is a piece of the endpoint function here, which comes from the interaction here, where I fix the outside fields to be whatever the fields were. So that's how I look at it. So you start with the effective fields to the S matrices, and these are the components of the S matrix, which map into the S matrix. Yeah, right, exactly. It's an effective vertex. That's what it looks like. And then if you expand the effective vertex, you get all the things. I'll get to all of them in a second. So this is just saying that, you know, when you say effective vertex, you don't have a theory yet. And at that level. And the astonishing thing is, even if it's not, I can say something at that level. And then this will work regardless of what theory you're doing. That's the power of this. This is very far where you haven't specified anything yet. Right? So saying that I have a finite category just means that, you know, I have something that I can write down and actually have some sort of interaction. But if you can, I'm not even telling you what. No, I'm not saying anything about it. Except that I want this thing that sort of, you have a renormalization, that if I have a vertex, I see this effective thing, right? So, you know, that's a linear equation or something like that. So if I see this effective expansion, I see a vertex, I can plug into that vertex again. And that's the hereditary condition of this condition too. That means that if I see something, I could plug it in there and expand it, re-expand it up. That's what's going on. But you don't need to know this. It's just a definition about a category. Okay? And so you see, I'm getting giddy, but I really like this because it works for so many things that you didn't expect it to work for. So, and the remark here, thank you for reminding me, I didn't say this, the theorem here is, if I take the subcategory that I just have aggregates, just these stars, and look at morphisms from stars to stars, that's a finite category. Not the full category of graphs, that won't work. Just this subcategory, okay? And now I can define all the objects you ever wanted, authorized and so on, in one slide. Now, corolla is a graph with one vertex and no edges. That's it. So, you know, it's an effective perfect, just external line. Right. So there you go. So, if you're after the classical objects that this is meant to generalize, what you do is you go through this category of graphs, and you restrict sort of the graphs you allow, the ghost graph you allow. if the gold stars are trees, basically you get 60 copyrights. And if you want copyrights, the gold stars should be rooted trees, but then the corollas should also be rooted. Okay? If you take pots, then all you have to do is you have to take the corollas with ins and outs, and that's a rectograph. If you want modular operands, you just take corollas, take a genus function on them as well, and just take any graph. So it's really nice. So any type of, so this could go on, you know, anything modular operands, the real props, so the operands and whatever, it's just, you massage, you get conditions on the ground, the gold graph. That's it. And so now actually the first time you can say that all these operatic like things are exactly the same. Now they're just functions. They're just kind of, you know, they're just functions for finding categories. Yes. Both. It's conditions and extra structures. So it's directed as an extra structure, rooted with an extra structure, you put it on with extra structures and conditions. Okay? So see, this is one. That's, so I have all these things. So you could ask about algebra, this is where you come in, you know, this is the first thing, then you know how to stretch it out and how to get correlation functions, you should get a vector space of field in there. And this is how you get the vector space of field in there. So algebra is over operands. This is a little tricky. To talk about algebra over operands, you have to fix some standard functor, so some standard operand. So, you know, an algebra over an, actually an algebra over an operand, what is it? It's an operand morphism from your operand to this form operand, so morphism in your function. Okay? So, in general, you can do algebra in this generality, but you'd have to specify something, a standard functor from the object in your category, depending on modeling your category. So for process, you know, it's harm of V tensor or X tensor N to X tensor M. You have to give me something. For cyclic operands, it's a harm of X tensor N to X, but then you also have to have a duality from X. So as long as you have a standard thing, an algebra over this guy will be functors between, sorry, natural transformation between two functors. So that's, and then that's the first setup when you have to do the field theory. That's all you need. So you need the space of fields, you need to the correlation functions will actually do the standard representation for you, and then you have all these operations. All right. What else can you do? So this is, you can do enriched versions, and this is also important. So the optimal, I've just been talking about categories, so the morphisms are like morphism sets. I might want my morphism sets not to be sets, but vector spaces, say, right? Or topological spaces, and I can do that. That can be done. This is important if you want to do what are called modular operands, which you do need for many things, like brackets. So this is the first time you can sort of actually treat modular operands and operands the same. And so it's like twisted modular operands and modular operands in the same type of setup. So otherwise they're really hard to define. Then you can go back to this question. So V can have many objects, but you could ask, what if V is the smallest possible I can think about? Then you just fill your category, one element, one identity map. We've already done the computation, then V tensor is basically the natural numbers with SN action. Now, giving a Simon category without V, the theorem says that that's the same thing as giving an operand, and you say O of N is this harm, so this is not a typo, depending on how you want to do one corresponds. Given an operand, you write harm N1 to be this, and then by this axiom that you have decomposition, you know what all the harm N are. Because they just decompose, and this sum of the mi to 1. And the other way around, you just set this thing to be on, and then if you go back here, you see that this is exactly, if you go back here and go down to one thing, you see that this is exactly this operand composition that you take. If you have om1 after omn, contented that with om, you get a map into, you get a map which is the composition, which is the map from n to 1. So that's just, so then, and in this case now, the op, since you now starts to be different from what you started with, because I'm not giving the operand, I'm giving algebra over operand, actually. There's the op. And you can do a lot of other stuff. So you can do non-signal versions. The simplicial category is actually defined by the finding category cross-simplicial group. If you take a cross-simplicial group, that will give you a finding category. If you take FI algebra, you're doing a representation theory. So Benson Fogg has this wonderful invention of FI algebras, which he uses for stable representation theory. So these are basically finite sets with injections. That's also a finding category. So this is kind of nice. So the idea was to get something like operands, but you get something more. All right, so what else can we do? What kind of in universal constructions can we do? And just like we had, you know, this, so this is how I showed you this group example. Remember, sort of, if I have the functor between two groups, and I have a functor which is a representation, then the question said I'm putting back with induction and restriction. I can do the same thing with the full finding categories, right? And so I can have induction and restriction with full finding categories. So for people that know these things, so for instance, the prop generated by an operand. That's a push forward from the finding category of operand to the finding category of prop. You can do the restriction, so anything, so this is really, really nice, this is what McLean said, everything should be a kind extension, everything is a kind extension, so all the constructions you can do, so that's one set of constructions, second extra restriction. Then another thing you can do is Kolmogorov transforms and resolutions, and I think I have the time, I can tell you something about that, how to think about that. We can do Kolmogorov transforms, bar transforms, resolutions, and Simon transforms. And so this is rather hard, because basically when I said something like the word resolution, so for an algebra you would take a free resolution, but then I said this is a quite general setup, I didn't say anything about linear or anything, so we need some model category structures to say what free resolutions should be, or what resolutions are, as co-fibrin objects. We did that. I'm not going to torture you with that. That is in the paper, so that's 80 pages if you meant that, you can get it at the end. And sort of, the Simon transforms, they're related, so this is again something that we wanted from this paper on master equations. One of the other reasons somehow, what is it? So A, in these master equations, you have brackets and BV operators. So there's a two-part question. One, where do these brackets and BV operators come from? And two, how do I get the master equations? And for that, I need Simon transforms. And I'll explain that in a second. And And then Fund 4 is something which is really surprising. So this is joint work with, I should have said the first thing, but I probably didn't say that. So the Fund category paper, but it's